Fly me to the moon. Let me play among the stars. And let me see what spring is like on a Jupiter and Mars. In other words, hold my hand.
Hi, Dad.
Hello.
Welcome to day one of our oral history project. For the record, today is July 2nd, 2016, and we're in our favorite place, Livingston Manor, New York. And everyone in the family is really excited about this project because we want to find out who you are and what your childhood was like, what your family was like, because today you're 93 and you're terrific. Grandfather and father and partner, so let's get started. Question one, where and when were you born?
I was born June 10th, 1923, in a section of Brooklyn called Brownsville, and specifically it was on what's called Howard Street. And when I was 4 years old, we moved to another section of Brooklyn called Crown Heights. And we lived there until I was 17, and then we moved to a third section, also in Brooklyn, called Flatbush. Now, you may have other questions you want to ask me, so let's go back to wherever.
Okay, so let's get back into some of your family history. Your parents. Let's first start by talking about your mom and dad. Your mother's name was Susan Solomon. Your dad was Morris Wolkoff. What do you know about them? Where were they born? When did they come to the United States? What was your father's occupation? Go ahead.
Well, my father, and I don't know too much of as to where he was born, other than it was somewhere in Russia. And, I'm sorry to this day that when I was younger, I didn't ask more of my father. But when you're young, you tend not to ask these questions. And they really didn't speak too much of their background. So he came from Russia, maybe around an age of 20, something like that. My mother was born in Poland, and at the time was called Russia-Poland, because Poland, prior to World War II, actually prior to World War I, had been subdivided into various sections which were administered by different countries. And so she was in that part of Poland, which was close to Warsaw, and that was administered by Russia.
And what year do you think they came here?
Well, my mother was six. I was born when she was 30, so I think she was born in 1893, which means she came somewhere around the turn of the century. And my father, who was 10 years older than my mother, came when he was about 20, so he probably came a few years later.
And how did they meet, do you know?
I don't have any idea.
Okay. So do you know anything about their families, your grandparents, or did they experience anti-Semitism in Europe? What language did your dad speak? What do you know about him?
Well, the only grandparent I knew was my mother's father, who lived with me, or with us, I should say, for a number of years. And I used to call him Zadie, which, of course, is Yiddish for grandfather. The only other relative that I knew of, from either my mother or my father's side, was a sister of my father who lived in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, and she had children. She was married, she had children, and on occasion we would go out to Pittsburgh and visit. Not very frequently, but every once in a while. And that was it. And as best I know, my father had siblings who were still in Russia. Supposedly, and I say supposedly because I was never told this, I think it came from my sister Rosalind. My father had a sister who lived in Germany. I think she was married to a German Jew. And my father, again supposedly, went to Germany to go to college because, as you might know, it was very difficult for Jewish boys or girls, for that matter, but primarily boys, to attend a school of higher education in Russia. So if the story is correct, he went to Germany to be with his sister and went to Heidelberg University, but I don't think he graduated. And at some point then, he came across the United States.
Do you know why they came to the United States, either of your parents?
I don't know why my mother's family came to the United States. Well, this was, they came to the United States during the period when there was a mass exodus of Jews and Italians and others from Eastern Europe and Southern Europe. You know, there was a lot of anti-discrimination or anti-Jewish discrimination in Russia at the time for many years. And so a lot of the Russian Jews and the Ukrainian Jews who lived in Ukraine and Lithuania and so forth, they came to the United States and during that period. And my father, and again this is supposition, he may have come because of the war that was taking place between Russia and Japan. And they were...
What year?
I think that war took place somewhere around 1907. I'm not quite sure. Jeff, yes? Question?
1904.
Okay. So I was off 3 years. And so maybe instead of my being 93, I'm only 90.
And what language did they speak when they came here? Do you know?
Well, my mother came at 6, mm-hmm. So she immediately went into elementary school, and she had absolutely no accent.
But her first language was?
Her first language was English, yes. Essentially, it was almost as if she had been born in the United States in terms of culture and language. My father, as I said, came over, and I'm not quite sure, somewhere around 20, and did have an accent. But he spoke good English, as far as I can remember.
But their first language was Yiddish, or
they
Polish?
Did speak Yiddish. No, my mother spoke Yiddish probably because her father spoke Yiddish, and she always, and I don't remember, but she must have spoken Yiddish to him. But I do remember my mother and father occasionally speaking Yiddish to one another.
Okay, and what was your father's career? How did he support the family? And then I understand he became sick. If you could talk a little bit about that.
Right. My father, I know, became an insurance agent, sold life insurance. He worked for an agency which sold with Travelers Life Insurance Company. And in 1930, which was just after the depression had started, he did very, very well. And as a result, because he sold enough insurance, he and my mother were sent to Florida to the Breakers Hotel, which is in Palm Beach, as were many of the others who were salespeople who had attained that sales level. And he took me, because I was only 7 at the time, and my brother, who was 10 years old, he was 17, and my sister Arthur was 6.5 years older, so she was around 13, 14. They stayed home. And what I do remember, and I don't know if my memory is correct or not, but once again, because of anti-Semitic discrimination, those who stayed at the Breakers Hotel had to live on certain floors, separate from the general population. I may be wrong on this, but that's what I seem to remember. But from that point on, from 1930 on, as far as income was concerned, my father's income and the family income went downhill.
Because of the Depression?
Well, the Depression was very heavy at the time, yeah. And my father began to take sick.
And do you know what was wrong with him?
Well, I know two things. Number one, he was ill for a period of around 8 years. And I don't know whether it progressed as time went on. I assume it did. What the cause was, I don't know. But I remember there was a period where, and he died when I was 16, so probably when I was somewhere around 14 and 15, I remember going with him on one of his calls. He was still trying to sell insurance, and it was very difficult for him to walk, and I sort of had to support him.
How did you survive then? Who supported your family?
To finish the story, he died when I was 16 at the Unity Hospital, which was directly across from where we lived. And I remember standing at the top of the stairs. We lived on the second floor. When my brother and mother came back from the hospital and said that my father had died. And from what I was told, that he supposedly had a—I say supposedly, because I'm not sure—an ulcer of some sort. Maybe the ulcer became so severe that they couldn't do anything with it, and as a result, he died. Today, I'm sure, if the same condition existed, he would still be alive, you know, because of the antibiotics.
So do you remember as a child being poor, or did you feel like you were, money was an issue, or how?
Well, money was an issue. So obviously, my father couldn't work.
And your mother was a homemaker?
My mother was at home. My brother Sidney, who I said was 10 years older than I, so when my father died, he was 26. So he, prior to my father dying, he had been in college at St. John's University. And he had to stop, he had to quit school and go to work, because otherwise there would have been no income. And I think, I didn't know it at the time, and I didn't know it for many, many years, but just before my brother Sidney died, he indicated that he had resentment, that he had been put in that position, where he had to support the family. But that was life.
How would you describe your childhood? Was it...
Childhood was a happy childhood.
So despite financial hardship you felt, what made it happy?
Well, to begin with, the brunt of having to make a living or supporting the family didn't fall on me. I went to school and played ball and hung out with my friends.
How do you think your friends would have described you as a teenager? How would they have described you as a teenager, as a friend? What do you think they would have said about you?
Well, first of all, they didn't call me Harold, it was called Lefty. That was a nickname. I was friendly with everybody as far as I can remember. There were some I liked more than others, obviously. There was a group of us. I was close with some than I was with others. It was a group of guys that we played ball, we talked about ball afterwards, we hung out on Eastern Parkway in the evening, listened to the Yankee ball game. Jeff will be happy with that. and it was a good life. I really had a good life in spite of the fact that there was no money to speak of, and I didn't need money.
You didn't feel deprived.
I did not feel deprived, no.
Were your friends from a similar background?
Yeah, they're lower middle class.
Jewish.
Whether they were at the same level of financial income, I don't know. I think They were better off than we were generally. I think so. I think one of them, at least one, may have had a car. You know, parents may have had a car. Yeah, because I remember being in the car when Joe Louis and Max Smelling, remember that? Ford, and it was being put on the radio, you know, over the radio. Yeah. So they were in better shape, probably. But it didn't, nobody knew the difference, really.
And how would you...
I don't think any of them went to camp. Not that I can remember. We played ball in the schoolyard. And it was like a camp. Yeah.
What were your living arrangements like? What did the apartment look like? Did you have to share a room?
Okay. As I said, we were on a second floor above stores. I think it was an upholstery store below, something like that. And I remember sleeping with my brother, and we occupied one of the bedrooms, so we slept in the same bed. And my grandfather lived with us. That was my mother's father. And I think there was a room off to the side with a separate entrance, and we had a boarder. There was someone who was a single man, and he would pay us X number of dollars per week or per month, whatever. And for how long he was there, I don't remember. I do remember there being trolley cars that ran along the street outside the house, in the apartment. And you would hear those trolley cars go, you know, they made a lot of noise. But, you know, you get used to it. And so it was not a problem sleeping while the trolley cars were going.
And how did your mother wash the clothes, or what do you remember her cooking, or what was her life like?
We didn't, in those days, you didn't have a wash machine, you didn't have a dryer. You washed clothes by hand, and you hung them up on a line, either interior or exterior. She did all the cooking. I remember when you bring up food, I went to a elementary and junior high school, all in one, which was about two, three blocks away. And during lunchtime, we had enough time for me to walk back to the house, have my lunch, which very often consisted of rye bread and beans, and walk back to the school. So, talking about the school, it was had a very good student body. It was a junior high school, so I went there until, including the ninth year, the ninth grade, which meant that I spent the equivalent of the first year in the junior high school. And then when it came time to go to the regular high school for the remaining 3 years, I decided I would want to go to either Stuyvesant High School or Brooklyn Tech. And the reason was because I was good in math. Now, Stuyvesant High School I discounted immediately because the educational program there was to prepare someone for college. And I knew that was not for me, you know, at least on a full-time basis.
Because of
the financial mm-hmm. conditions. Brooklyn Tech had a variety of programs. It wasn't a scholarship school, but you had to take an exam, and it was a selective school based on the exam. And so I decided to do that with the knowledge, I guess I knew that at the time, that I would have to go another 4 years, which was the case. So I had a year of high school and junior high school, and I had another 4 years in Brooklyn Tech. So actually, I went to high school for 5 years. But I did it because I felt that after graduating from Brooklyn Tech, I would have enough background to go out and get a job. So I went into one of their programs called the Structural Technology Program. And it was a precursor to structural engineering, but on a high school level. And when I graduated from Brooklyn Tech, I applied for a couple of jobs. One, I remember two, one of which I got. And the one I'm about to tell you now, I did not get. And that was Bell Labs. Now, Bell Labs doesn't exist today, but at that time, it was the research arm of AT&T. As you may know, AT&T was the only telephone company out there. And so AT&T provided telephone service, but they had Bell Labs as its research, and the other division they had was called Western Electric, which did the manufacturing. So research, manufacturing, and then the service of telephone. So I applied to the Bell Labs. They gave me a test, which involved working on the board. Working on a board means a drafting board. And I thought I did okay. And I'm sure I did okay because at Brooklyn Tech, I was in the upper 10% of the graduating class. And that was selective in terms of the students they took. And so I must have been a very good student, or at least reasonably good. But when I finished the test at Brooklyn Tech, Bell Labs, I sat down for an interview with this gentleman, and I remember it to this day. And he asked me a number of questions, of course, and he's looking at my application. And in those years, it was not illegal for the application to ask for your religion. It is today, and has been for years. You can't do that today. So my religion was there, and he said to me, where were your parents born? So, of course, I had answered the question. I was not going to say to him, son of your business. So I told him my father was born in Russia, my mother was born in Poland. In retrospect, and I didn't get the job, incidentally. In retrospect, why was he asking me where my parents were born? What did that have to do with the kind of job I could do, or the type of person I was? So obviously I had to do with the religion. Anyway, I didn't get that job.
Did you ever think about not listing your religion? Was that an option that went through your head?
No, never thought about denouncing my religion or pretending that I was not Jewish, no.
Did you identify yourself as being Jewish as a child? Was it, did you attend synagogue? Did you observe holidays? Were you bar mitzvahed?
We didn't attend synagogue. My grandfather did. He was a religious person, and he would go to synagogue frequently. I could say every morning, I don't remember, frequently, to a synagogue which was down in the basement, I remember this, on Lincoln Avenue, a couple blocks from the house. And when it came time for me, when I was 13, I was not ready to be bar mitzvah. I had never gone to the Hebrew school. And when I asked my mother and father why I hadn't gone to Hebrew school, they said they couldn't afford it. Okay. But at 13, I decided I wanted to be bar mitzvah because I felt that sometime in the future, I might look back and say, why wasn't I bar mitzvah? I'm unhappy that I wasn't bar mitzvah.
Was your brother bar mitzvah?
Probably, but I really don't remember. So I don't know. It could have been a number of factors, one of which I'm pretty sure I was looking ahead, and I felt I wanted to be bar mitzvah so that looking back, I wouldn't be disappointed. And maybe because my friends were being bar mitzvah, so there could have been peer pressure of some sort. Anyway, since I couldn't read Hebrew, I couldn't go to a formal bar mitzvah. So my grandfather said, on Monday and Thursday mornings, you can go to synagogue and say a prayer, and that would be the equivalent of it would be considered bar mitzvah. So how did I learn to say that prayer? Well, my grandfather would say the prayer, and it was written phonetically. And I would read it phonetically. My grandfather would correct me in terms of pronunciation. And I memorized it. And I thought I was in pretty good shape. So when it came to having the bar mitzvah, which was probably on a Thursday morning, prior to my going to school, they stood me at a lectern, and on either side of me, I remember this, on either side of me there was a man who probably was in the 50s, 60s, whatever. They, of course, they looked very old to me. I was 13. And they said, okay, go to it. And I started the prayer. And whatever the prayer started with, by the time I finished pronouncing that first word, they were already up to the fifth word. I was lost. So all I did was open and close my mouth, pretending I was saying the prayer. So,
the intent, they have a celebration afterwards, or?
Yeah, the intent was good. I mean, the intent was there. I felt I was bar mitzvah, of course, I wanted to be. We didn't have anything after that, other than my mother made some honey cake, and what's the other cake? The white cake.
Sponge cake.
And at the back of the synagogue, they set up a table, and the cake was put out there, I guess, with some wine. And the congregants would come back and partake. And I remember there's this one gentleman who would take some pieces of cake and stuff in his pocket. Well, that's understandable. You know, things were tough in those years.
And then you went to school.
And then I went to school, yeah, right. And that was my bar mitzvah.
Okay, so let's get a little bit into, do you remember your family being political at all? Do you remember your father being somewhat of an intellectual? How would you describe your parents and your siblings?
I don't remember anything political being said. My father read a Yiddish paper called the Tug, translated means the day. And in those years, there were quite a few Yiddish papers. And they went from left-leaning to right-leaning. The left-leaning paper, there may have been others, but one that was prominent was the Forwards. Mm-hmm. He did not read that. He read the Tug, as I said. And I think the Tug may have been a middle of the roader in terms of, you know, political...
Do you remember talking about politics at the dinner table? Or
no, I don't. I don't. My brother read, of course, he read the English paper. He read the World Telegram, which was not a leftist, not a right. It was perhaps a little more to the right than the Times was.
And were you close to your siblings, or how do you remember Aunt Roz and Uncle Sidney? What were they like?
Well, to begin with, my brother was 10 years older, so that, you know, you're dealing with a different culture, essentially. You know, he grew up having different friends, going to work, going to college, going to work, whatever. So that was very different. But I always felt that he was, you know, not a father, but he was looking after me, to whatever extent. My sister, Roz, who was 6.5 years older than I, again, I don't remember this, but what I was told, she resented having to take me along with her at times when she was with her friends, because I guess my father or mother couldn't be with me for whatever reason. So that's about it. So the age difference did call for very, you know, for closeness as I was growing up, which I had my friends, they had their friends, you know, different groups.
And tell us a little bit about your first early work experience and how you ended up serving in World War II.
Well, my first work experience was with a firm called Mayer Manufacturing. And at the time, they were making kitchen cabinets, steel kitchen cabinets. While I was working, after high school obviously, I started to go to college at night, and I went to what was called Brooklyn Polytechnic Institute. It's now Polytechnic University. It's now part of NYU. And went at night for a year and a half and started civil engineering. And then I was drafted. At the end of the year and a half, I was
How old were you?
Taken into service. I was 19 and a half. Remember, I graduated high school at 18. Normally, I would have graduated at 17. But because I went for 5 years, I was 18. And I worked for a year and a half and went to school at night. And then I was drafted to the service. And we were shipped down to Miami Beach for basic training. We'd get up early in the morning. We'd go out for marches and training. You know, you have a drill instructor. And I remember that one night I had guard duty out on the beach, and they gave me a rifle. And I tell you, I was scared because they were concerned about the submarines in those years. Mm-hmm. And they knew there were Germans from the submarines who had left the submarine and gone on to U.S. soil, somewhere along those, you know, Miami Beach or elsewhere. So I didn't know what was going to come, but so, you know, it was dark, I was alone, and I was a little concerned as I walked up and down. And from there, I was shipped to the Grand Rapids. Anyway, so I was being trained as a weather observer, but they told us that the top 10% of the graduating class would then go on to forecasting school. Now remember, the first quarter or month or whatever is when the grades came out, I was top banana. I was number one. But I wasn't when I graduated. Well, from there, let me give you that story. You've heard this, I think, but I'll give it to you again. When we graduated, they put up on the board that Mr. Jones, Private Jones is going here, Private Smith is going there, and so forth. And for me, they had me going into New York. The time came for me to report. The day before, I said, okay, I look at my orders, and there's nowhere for me to go other than New York. So I went down to, I went to Manhattan, I was living in Brooklyn, and on Times Square they had a recruitment booth. And I went up to them and I said, you know, I don't know where I'm supposed to go. I got to report tomorrow. They said, we don't know either. But there is a Coast Guard station. I don't know why Coast Guard, but there was a Coast Guard station. And they said it's on whatever street. Go there and they may be able to help you. And I went there and the guy says, yeah, we know where you have to go. Of course, they knew I was, you know, I guess it said weather observer. And they said, but we have to take you. So they took me over to one of the buildings, which happened to be an AT&T building in Manhattan somewhere. They had an armed guard down in the lobby, and they took me to where one of the floors, and that's where I had to be. And the reason it was difficult to find is because it was a very important building. It was the center for all of the metropolitan area in terms of controlling aircraft, the aircraft control center. And it was there that they knew whether or not the planes that were flying should be flying, or whether or not they were possibly from enemy sources. So I was there for a period of time, and then I got my orders to go down to Trinidad, which is in the Caribbean. And at the time, the Caribbean was considered a war zone. And it was considered a war zone because of the U-boat activity. A lot of ships were being sunk by these U-boats, German U-boats. And they issued us a rifle. War zone. Of course, I was not involved with any shooting or anything of that sort, but so I was in a war zone, I don't know, maybe 3, 4, 5 months. And then by that time, they had taken care of the U-boats to the extent that they were no longer a big threat as they took it off the war. I think if you were in a war zone, you got an additional pay, I think. I don't remember what it was. Anyway, then it went back to being, you know, just an area. And I was in Trinidad for a while, and then I was shipped to Curacao. Stayed there for a period of time. We had air bases there. I was stationed at air base. Then he sent me to French Guiana. And French Guiana was an air base out in the jungle. But of course, you had, you know, everything there. And then from there, they shipped me to Cuba, or sent me to Cuba. And while I was, incidentally, while I was at these various islands, you know, we had softball teams, amongst other things. And so I was on a softball team. I was a first baseman, you know, so forth. And I was a pretty good hitter in those days. So they were sorry to see me go. They really were. And so then went to Cuba. And I spent 10 months. I remember the amount of time there. I spent 10 months in Cuba at what was called Batista Air Base. Batista was then the dictator and control of Cuba. San Antonio de los Baños. That was the name of the town. And periodically we would go to Havana, it was about 30 miles away. And there was a Jewish population, they had a fairly large Jewish population in Havana. And they took the soldiers under their wing, and we'd eat, you know, queso, and we'd have dinner with them. And we went out with the young girls, you know, our race and so forth. And I think we can stop now and maybe check, okay?
That's good.
I think we've had more than enough,
yes.
I can tell.
I can tell, that's good. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You did great.
Very good.
Yeah, I put you to sleep, it must be.
Ruth found it very exciting.
Did she? Why, she fell asleep?
She's sleeping.
Oh, she.
Good afternoon.
We're here on July 30th, 2016, and we're picking up on our oral history. Do you remember where you were during Pearl Harbor, and what
yes.
was the reaction of
yes,
those
do.
That were around you or the community?
Don't remember. It was a Sunday. I was with friends up in somebody's apartment, and we were watching a football game. It must have been the Giants against, I don't remember whom. And of course, the announcement came through that Pearl Harbor had been attacked. And I guess we figured, well, here's the war. And the following day, President Roosevelt must have indicated that we were at war with Japan.
Was there a feeling that war was inevitable, or that America would kind of sit on the sidelines while Germany and Japan were?
Well, we were involved to the extent that we were supplying Great Britain with destroyers. I think we sent 50 destroyers, if I remember correctly. They called the Lend-Lease. So we had our hand in a war, and of course there were people, Americans, who had volunteered to fly with the RAF and the Canadian Air Force. But on the other hand, there were those who were against the war, and many of them were fascist. You know, we had our people in the States who were sympathizers with Germany. In fact, I don't know if it's true or not, I've been told that here in the Livingston Manor area, they had the Bund, the German Bund.
I've heard they were upset.
Yeah.
I have a question also. At that time, what did you hear about what was happening with the Holocaust? Did you hear that there were Jews in the camps being exterminated? What did you hear about that? And then subsequently, what did you hear about what Roosevelt was doing about that?
I can't tell you what I heard. I don't remember whether I heard anything about the Holocaust at the time or not, because there's been so much about the Holocaust since that it sort of all blends in.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know when my awareness started. Mm-hmm. As far as Roosevelt was concerned, we didn't realize at the time that he had decided not to bomb the railroad tracks that was, you know, carrying the on which the trains were traveling, carrying people to the camps, or bombing the camps themselves. That came out much later.
Mm.
Yeah.
Do you have any family that you know of that passed away during the Holocaust? Or?
Just an assumption that my father's family, and I indicated that he had siblings
mm-hmm.
who had remained in Russia. I don't know what happened to them. I assume, you know, depending what part of Russia he was from, they might have been overrun by the German army. And if they were, then that was the end of that for them. If they were the eastern part, maybe they were able to move out of there, or maybe the Russians gave them a hard time. I don't know.
So after you were discharged, can you describe how you found work, or you know what you did in the aftermath of your discharge?
When I was discharged, I went back to school as a full-time student. Went back to Polytechnic Institute of Brooklyn, where I had been going prior to the war, prior to being drafted, and you know, I'd been there at night. So I went back as a full-time student. Thanks to the GI Bill of Rights. And if I remember correctly, they paid the tuition, the GI Bill did. And I think they gave a stipend of maybe $20 or something like that, a week, a month, I don't even remember. Which was not sufficient. Of course, my mother was widowed. I was living with my mother. She was working in A&S at the time. That's a department store in Brooklyn. And I had to make some additional money. So when classes were over, I get on a train and I go out to Greenpoint to work at the same place I worked at prior to the war. You know, they took me back on a part-time basis. And I used to do my, as I indicated previously, I think I used to do my homework on the train, going there, coming back. Wherever I could do it, I did it. And I worked there during the time I was going to school, you know, that four-year period. At the end of, and then I met Grandma Goldie while I was in school. I probably was a senior at the time.
Would you tell us how you met her and where?
Sure.
And how old were you and what year?
I met her, I guess I must have been about 25. Maybe the latter part of 24, the early part of 25, something like that.
How old was she at the time?
Well, she was 4.5 years younger. And how did I meet her? Well, one night, a number of us was hanging around on the street, you know, in front of a candy store, which was a typical thing to do. And the question was, what are we going to do tonight? So someone suggested we go to the Brooklyn Jewish Center, where they were having a basketball game. Now, the background on that is that in those years, well, to begin with, there were no Jewish centers in Brooklyn or in New York, period. I don't believe there was a Jewish center. They were all synagogues. You know, if you went out of town to the small communities, cities or the towns, and there was a Jewish population, they would have a Jewish center, but they didn't have it in New York, to my knowledge. So it was synagogues, and each synagogue, pretty much, or a good number of synagogues, had basketball courts. They had big gyms, you know, a good-sized gym with a basketball court. And there was a league of basketball teams sponsored by these synagogues. And on these teams, you had top five players. In those years, a lot of the college ball play and basketball players were Jewish, interestingly enough. And many of them would play in those leagues. So the games were good games. So in any case, we went to the Brooklyn Jewish Center that night to see a basketball game. And do you want to stop this? No? Okay. For those of you who might not have heard, Jeff's phone was ringing. Cell phone. Okay. So we went to the basketball game. I assume with the knowledge that there would be a dance afterward, but I'm not sure. We went primarily for the basketball game. And there was a dance afterwards. This was, I guess, typical of those games. And a friend of mine, Harold Cohn, asked Grandma Goldie to dance. How he came to it, I don't know. And then he said, Harold, would you like to dance with her? Why he asked me, again, I don't know. Maybe they didn't hit it off, whatever. And so I danced with her and got to talking. Where are you from? And she was from the Lower East Side. And I said, well, what are you doing here in Brooklyn? She said, well, a number of friends, her girlfriends, And she decided, let's go into one of these synagogues in Brooklyn where they're having the basketball games and dances afterwards. Actually, they were interested in the dances, not the basketball game. And maybe we'll meet some college guys from Brooklyn. And sure enough, that's what happened. So she told me it's from the Lower East Side. I said, the Lower East Side? I wasn't particularly happy with that, traveling to the Lower East Side, but we got along very well, obviously, and it continued. Yes?
Where did you take her on your first date?
I don't know if it was my first date or not, but I remember this. It may have been my first date. Fort Tyrone Park? We went up to Fort Tyrone Park, which overlooks the Hudson, and we went picnicking. So instead of a blanket, we took a roll of paper. You know, this wrapping paper, and we put it on the ground, and we lay on the wrapping paper, and overlooked the Hudson. We had a terrific time. So. I think that was the first time we went out. Yeah.
Okay, Dad. We're going to switch gears a little bit and talk about your marriages. You were married twice, and now luckily you have a relationship with Ruth for 24 years. So let's go back a little bit to your first marriage with my mother, Grandma Goldie. You talked about how you met her. Can you talk a little bit about what you remember of her, what your marriage was like, and then let's get a little bit into what it was like being a parent.
Well, she was a doll, and she was loved just about everybody, by everybody. And I've always said, of the two of us, she was the better person, and I mean it. Unfortunately, of course, she died at a very early age. She just turned 51. I think we had a good life. Of course, it was a short life, unfortunately, together.
The first year, did you live with your in-laws?
Yeah. When I married her, I was 26. I had just graduated from college. She was teaching. She started teaching when I think she was 21. And to save some money, we moved in with her folks, who lived in, as I said before, they lived in downtown Manhattan. And we lived there for a year and a half with her parents. And they were wonderful people. I called her mother Mom, I called her father Pop. And at the end of the year and a half, we moved to Queens, to Forest Hills in Queens, where a new development of garden apartments had been put up. And we had, by this time, we had met Aunt Rainey and Uncle Bob. And they moved to the same development. We moved there first and they followed us. And how did we meet Uncle Bob and Aunt Rainey? As I said, Mom was teaching at a school in downtown Manhattan. Uncle Bob was teaching at the same school, and they liked each other, and so Uncle Bob and Aunt Rainey invited us over to their place. And their place was in the basement of this building. I think it was maybe a two-story building. They lived in the basement, and where the burner was, you know, the coal burner and so forth. And why there? Because then, and this must have been, let's say we were married in 1949, so it must have been 1949, 1950. It was extremely difficult to get apartments. And so I felt fortunate to be able to get this basement apartment. And so we visited with them. I met them for the first time, obviously. And Aunt Rainey made a chocolate, wait a minute, a cream chocolate pudding pie. Yeah, cream chocolate pudding pie. And I remember to this day because I loved it. And we became very strong friends, as you know, and our kids and we had the kids in Forest Hill, the garden apartment, as they did, and Aunt Rainey and Mom used to watch the kids together and so forth, and the kids grew up together until that's Mom and I, decided we needed a larger place. And so we moved to another garden apartment, which was in Whitestone. That was a two-bedroom, I think one bath. But the kids slept in the second bedroom. That was you and Uncle Michael, of course. And Aunt Randy and Uncle Bob followed us, and they picked up an apartment in the same community. And again, the kids were with some walking distance from one another. So, you grew up with Richard, with Susan and Richard.
What do you remember about being a parent for myself and Michael? What do you remember us as kids? What were we like?
Well, I remember
any of the challenges.
You were a joy. You really were a joy. Of course, as time went on, you became teenagers. It was less of a joy, perhaps. But my attitude was, you're teenagers. This is normal, being a teenager. And, I guess I was a strong parent. I don't know, because you reacted to it, you more than Uncle Michael. And so I can understand it. If I was tough on you, you weren't going to enjoy it. But it was just my philosophy. I felt that I had grown up in tough times. I thought I was the better for it. Nobody owed me a living. I had to do what I had to do in order to survive. And I didn't want you or Michael to be in a position other than that. And hopefully it worked to your benefit.
So, in terms of being a parent, any specific advice that you would have for your own grandchildren as they,
No, each has to do to whatever they're comfortable with. I was comfortable doing what I did because I thought it was the best I could do as a parent. It doesn't always work out that way, obviously. Whatever I did, frankly, not because it was for my benefit, and I felt it was for the benefit of the children. And that was paramount in my mind. And of course, the same was true in Mom's mind. So as far as grandchildren are concerned, they got to do what they're comfortable with and what they think is best for their kids.
Speaking of grandchildren, how do you remember Gary and Stephen and Julia's grandchildren? What are some of the memories you have of them?
Well, Gary was the first, of course. And we spent the most time with Gary because by that time, when Gary was born, I was, Grandma Goldie had died, and I was married to Grandma Ann. And so we used to take Gary, pick him up at preschool, I remember.
Forest Hills Jewish Center.
On the way to your apartment, we'd always stop and then we'd go in with him and buy him a cookie. And that was a routine. I don't know. Remember that, Gary? I don't know if you were very young at the time.
I do remember loving cookies.
Yeah. And I think you, Lori, and Gary would come over to our place, to the house.
Jeff would meet us there
where,
Wednesday afternoon.
Yeah, well, he would have dinner at least once a week. So it was a close relationship in terms of proximity, which helps, of course. And, I think we were comfortable with one another, wanted to be with one another. Steve came along. Julia, of course, was up in Rochester. So I would see Julia only occasionally. you know, compared to seeing Gary, it was as, almost as if I hardly ever saw her. And that, you know, that was obviously because of the lack of proximity. But we would go up to Rochester whenever we could, and she was, you know, Grandpa's here, Grandpa. Steve came along when, oh, wait a minute, when it was when I had just met Ruth, yeah. So wait a minute, Steve did not know Anne.
Correct.
Anne had died prior to Steve's being born, yeah. Right. So Steve grew up with Ruth. And again, I guess we didn't spend as much time with Steve, I didn't, as I did with Gary, because by that time, we were down in Florida for a period of time. So, you know, we didn't see Steve as often. But I remember playing ball with Steve, as I did with Gary. I remember Steve climbing up on the wall between you and between you and Mary's house. And I said, "Steve, don't do that, don't do it," because he was a little nothing at the time. So he was a daredevil. I remember that. Yeah.
And what do you remember of Julia?
Julia, I remember she had a terrific sense of direction. Yeah, because for even as a young kid, you might say, why that? But it was so significant. She was, when she was 3, 4, 5 years old, she remembered the direction in which to go. With, you know, it was uncanny. And she was a warm kid.
So let's talk a little bit about Grandma Anne. We can talk about Matt. And then how you got to meet Ruth.
Grandma Anne.
How long were you married for?
How did you meet Anne?
How did I meet Anne? Okay, let's go back there. After Mom had died, I didn't date for at least 7 months. And then finally I decided, well, okay. And so I had, you know, I had dates. People recommended women. And Aunt Randy and Uncle Bob were friendly with Anne's sister and brother-in-law, Bertram and Julie. To a common friend. And so Anne's husband had died, and I guess Aunt Randy must have said, gee, maybe this would be a good shidduch. So she recommended I take out Anne, Bertha's daughter, Bertha's sister, and I did, and it clicked. You know, we did very well together. And,
how long were you married to her before she passed away?
11 and a half years. And, well, you know, for whatever it's worth, she died after we had just come back from signing a contract to sell the house. And so I decided to go to Florida, even though Ann was no longer with me.
Why Florida?
Well, I was retired with Ann, and... Anne and I decided that we'd sell this house. Go to Florida, buy a place down there.
You would sell this house?
Yeah, we'd sell it. Oh. Yeah. She wasn't that happy here. She was happy, but not enough that she wanted to stay put. So when I was down in Florida, I met Ruth. Oh, how did I meet Ruth? Anne had some friends who I had met and became friendly with. And we had been invited to a party. And we would drive, and friends asked me if I wanted to go with them. Of course, I hadn't met Ruth at the time. And while we were in the car, the wife said to me, "Harold, are you dating yet, or would you like to meet somebody?" And I said, "Yes, I started dating." She said, "Okay, I'll put the word out." Next thing I know is I get a call from her that she has a number of someone, namely Ruth. And I called Ruth, asked her for a date, and you know, we went out for that the first date. I didn't realize that this friend of mine, or you know, Ruth of mine, didn't know Ruth. So when I went out with Ruth, I referred to it as a double blind date, because nobody knew anybody.
So what do you remember of that first date?
Well, I picked up, I went to Ruth, she had an apartment, as I said, in Florida, and she, as soon as she opened the door, I liked the looks of her. She was wearing, she had a nice shape, and of course, she was wearing slacks, which I liked. And she invited me in for a drink and some hors d'oeuvres. Yeah, questions.
And then you realized I better not use the Groupon I have in my pocket on this one.
So anyway, so we had a drink and some. Oh, when I called her, no. Prior to meeting her, I called her, of course, asking her to go out, and Ruth said, "Okay." She said, "How about going for a drink?" Right, Ruth? I think that's what she said, yeah. I said, no, I don't want to go for a drink. I want to go out for dinner. I guess that impressed her. The reason I wanted to go out for dinner primarily is because I had to eat somewhere. And I wasn't big on cooking. So, and I felt also going out for dinner, I would be spending some time with whomever it was, and I'd get to know them. With a drink, it could be very quick and out the door. Wherever you might be. So I went to her apartment to pick her up. She invited me in for a drink and some hors d'oeuvres, and we talked and so forth. And I said, I don't know the area. Do you have a restaurant you'd like to go to? She said, well, there's a Chinese restaurant very close. We can walk there and have dinner. I said, fine. And we walked out of the building, and as we did, I said to her, I see you have a pool. What's it like? She said, well, you want to take a look? I said, yeah. And the reason I asked was because in those years I was swimming. So as we entered, about to enter the pool, someone came out of the gate from the pool. You want me to tell the story, Ruth?
Sure.
Yeah, okay. And she said, hiya, whatever his name was. And he said, don't you talk to me.
Never heard.
So, which was, it sounded to me as if he was a little off the wall, but, and he walked past, and that was it. And then we went out to have dinner, and she told us, she met some people there from her building, and she told them the story, and they said, I know. It seems from what Ruth tells me that he and she were each running for president of the building. And she won, and he lost. And so we had it in for her, I guess. I don't know. So anyway, we had dinner at the Chinese restaurant. We had a terrific time. You know, I had her in stitches. She, you know, she's a laugher. And all I had to do was say Ruth, and she laughed. So all night long, I was saying Ruth. And she was in hysterics. And it took off from there. And Betsy, I moved in with her. And how do we get to Boca West? Of course, not everybody knows Boca West, but Boca West is a country club. And we got to it as follows. I was living with Ruth, but I went up north for a period of time, I guess it was a holiday, to be with the family, and she didn't go up north. And when I got back that night, she had made a terrific meal. It was, with a crust. It was
beef Wellington,
right. And I tell you, it was as good as it could be. Now, not that I'm an expert in beef Wellington, but I had beef Wellington, coincidentally, at the CIA, the Culinary Institute of America, some years back. and I sort of remember what it tasted like, and hers was superior. So I said to myself, ooh, I got myself a good cook here. Of course, she made it another time, it was terrible. But by then it was too late. So when I came back and she had that beef Wellington, she said to me, Harold, I'd like to move. I said, where? And she said, to Boca West. So it was an apartment that was available. That's why she was anxious to go there. She learned of the apartment to a cousin of hers, and she decided to buy the apartment, and we moved into Boca West. And of course, I moved with her, and you know, we maintain the apartment to this day.
Good
and move. I've been very happy there.
So, Dad, in meeting, in being married to Anne and being with Ruth, you developed a big extended family, you know. So you had Matt and you had Mark and you had Susan and Marcy. So you talk a little bit about each of them and how that enriched your life, you know, first with Matt and then the others.
Well, to begin with, I think both I and Anne and Ruth were and are fortunate in that each of the extended families for the three of us, once again, myself, Anne, and Ruth, we were fortunate that each of the extended families, we were comfortable with. There were no problems. I got along very well with Matt, and got along very well with my family. When it came to Ruth, I feel I get along very well with her family, and they get along, as you know, very well with Ruth, very close. So we were very fortunate. I've been fortunate, they've been fortunate, that the families came into play in a very positive manner, because he has so many stories. Whether it was second marriages or second relationships or third, whatever it may be, there are children that just give the parents a very hard time. And you hear cases where children won't talk to their parents because they married somebody else. So that's the story there.
I don't know if this is
part
of this. I think Grandpa should tell the story about how he and Goldie found the country house.
That's good.
Oh, okay. Yeah, Jeff, I don't know if you heard Jeff. He was speaking softly to Lori. He said, perhaps...
A rare occurrence, I might add.
He suggested I tell about how Goldie and I came to this house, in the country. It was a Sunday when...
What year also?
Oh, okay. It was 1970. It was April. I get a call from Sam on a Sunday, Sam Ugly's, and Sam says, how about going for a drive somewhere? I said, fine. He said, he went into the New York Times, the real estate section, and came up with three model homes up in the country somewhere. And they could be a destination. I said, okay, fine. Now I gotta tell you that we had absolutely no thought of buying a home. Neither Goldie or I or Sam or Glass. But it was a destination. So the first model home we were going to look at was east of the Hudson, and there's a college there, and I always have a problem coming. Two names, part of SUNY, part of State University of New York. So we went there, and drove to the model home, which we could not find. So the next stop was a model home in Lock Sheldrick, which is in the Catskills. And I looked at the map, and there were a couple of ways of going. One was to take the highway, which was a long way. The other was to go over a mountain, which was a much shorter trip. And so we started over the mountain, And I gotta tell you, that was as rough a trip as any I've been through. And I've driven in the Alps, and I've driven in the Rockies, I've driven in Mexico in the mountains, which were all rough. This was really hairpin turns. But we got to Lock Shelter, and we found the model home. It was on a lake, and we looked at the model home, and we said, nah, this is not for us, as if we were looking for a place. Now, it was about 4 o'clock. We had one more stop to make, which was here in the Chandelier. So I look at the map, and it looked as if it would be about a half hour away, something like that. But the problem was that Sam and Blanche had to get back to their place by 7 o'clock. Because they had an appointment with Big Al, who was, remember Big Al, Lori? Mm-hmm. He was our decorator. And I had recommended that he go to see Sam and Blanche. They wanted to do some revisions in their apartment. So I said, you know what? We're up here. Let's take a run over to see what it's about. And we'll turn around and get back to your house at 7 o'clock. So we come here. And I think we pulled up to the street that we're on. Maybe because there might have been a sign which said something, houses for sale. I don't remember exactly. And as we pull up, and we're sort of sitting there, this woman walks over to us, and she says, "Hiya, I'm the developer's wife, and we're living in one of the houses a couple blocks down the street." And she said, "The two houses you're facing are the last two houses being built. They're almost complete, but not quite. So you can't go in to see them because there's still some interior construction. But if you want to see what they look like, there's a house on the next street which is identical, and there's somebody there now." Remember, this was April, so it was, you know, cold weather. "There's somebody there now. And if you go over and introduce yourself, I'm sure he'll put, you know, Richard into the house." And we went to his house, and he had beds all over the place. He probably could have slept about 15 people, mm-hmm. if not more. But we got a sense of what the house looked like. So we come back to the car, and we're sitting in the car. And I guess we had already been told that the houses were going for about $17,000-$18,000, something like that. So she's back there waiting for us, and she said, "You know, my husband is going to be coming back soon to where we are, a couple blocks down. She said, why don't you hang out a little bit, and when he comes, I'll let you know, and then you could speak with him." So as we're sitting there in the car, I said to Goldie and to Blanche and to Sam, all of whom are off for the summer, including myself, I said, "You know, $17,000-$18,000, even then, was not a lot of money. And we were used to going on vacation, you know, during the summer. I said, what if we gave it a shot, tried the house for a summer, and if we didn't like it, so we'd sell the houses, and so we'd take a licking of $2,000-$3,000, whatever, and it would be like we had gone on vacation." And they all agreed it was, you know, a good possibility. By that time, she came back and she said, "My husband is here," and we pulled over to where they were living, and he came over. He said, "Why don't you come into the house? We'll have a drink, we'll talk, you know, a little bit." And so we came to the house, and I think by then we were sort of chomping at the bit, maybe to buy the houses. But it was a very distinct possibility. Of course, the area was gorgeous. Oh, I got to tell you that when we were sitting in the car and talking with the wife, we said, "You know, these houses are very close to one another, and you can see what's going on, hear what's going on, and so forth." She says, "Yeah, that's true. It's the winter time. The trees have no foliage, but once the foliage grows, you're not going to be able to see any of the house." So anyway, we investigated going to their house, and we're talking, and maybe in 5 minutes, the phone rings. And this guy, the developer, whose name was Grossmark, gets on the phone. He says, yeah, hiya, Mr. Smith. I remember you. You were here this morning, and you were looking at one of the two houses, but you said you want to look elsewhere and in order to make a decision. And now you've made a decision, and you're telling me that you want to buy one of the houses. He said, but you know what? I've got two couples here who are interested in these last two houses, and I got to give them preference. That'll close things out for me. And he hangs up. Well, that closed the deal, of course. And in 3 days, we owned these houses. And Sam, Blass has a little different story than I do, but Goldie and I wanted this corner house, and I think they wanted that house, and so there's no problem there. So that's how we came to it.
Okay, thanks, Dad.
Dad, this is your son, Michael, and today is September 3rd or 4th, 2016, Labor Day. We're all gathered here in the country, the family, and we're continuing our oral history project, learning about your life and trying to learn things that will make us live our lives in a hopefully a better way. So let me start with a bunch of questions about things you liked and why you liked them. And these are going to have to do with when you get to choose about what you want to do. Much of your life, in my view, has been choices you've had to make, either because your father passed away, because you had a family and had to support the family. And you know, this is not your answer, but this is my view, is the selflessness that you've displayed throughout your entire life in making our lives better. But you've had lots of opportunities also to make choices yourself. You've been when did you retire?
Officially 1986, but I did work for another year after that. In a practical sense, I've been retired since 1987.
And in that long period of time, for almost 30 years now, you've had a lot of time to make choices. So one thing I want to talk about is your food choices. Because what always astounded me is how unwilling you are to make a choice. So let me ask you, what do you really like to eat?
Much of what I like to eat I no longer can eat.
What did you like to eat?
For two reasons I can't eat it. Because of medical conditions. I have a kidney condition, so I've got to limit the amount of protein I take in from an animal of whatever sort. And the other reason is that I'm with Ruth and... that limits what I can eat as well. But that's okay, because frankly, I'm very happy with what we tend to eat. We tend to eat soups that she makes or that we buy when we're down in Florida at the club. We buy at the club. They occasionally have low sodium soups, so we'll pick that up. And Ruth will make a salad, and we're content with a good bread. That's a good meal for us. So I no longer have that need or desire to go out and have specific foods.
What did you used to like to eat? What was
your
favorite?
What did I used to like to eat? Okay. Grandma, my mother, used to make a stew, a lamb stew, which I liked. I liked eggplant parmesan or veal parmesan. I was never a big steak eater. I like sauerbraten. You know, if I went to a restaurant occasionally, I would have that if it was a German restaurant. I'm trying to think. Oh, stuffed cabbage. My mother made very good stuffed cabbage.
Feel free to talk about what you like to eat, not as a child, but let's say as an adult.
Yeah, as an adult. Well, when I say my mother made those foods, my desire for them continued afterwards, you know, into adult life. So that's pretty much it, I guess.
Dessert?
Desserts? I'm not a dessert eater. Well, I should rephrase that. When I say I'm not a dessert eater, I'm not just a dessert eater, I'm a very big dessert eater. So, yeah, I like desserts, obviously.
Which meal do you like? Which of the three meals a day, or four meals sometimes, do you most enjoy? What do you look, do you like? If you had a, only had one meal, would it be breakfast? Would it be dinner?
Well, that's going to be an easy one to come up with, because for breakfast, we only have oatmeal. And occasionally we might vary that, say about once a year, and have a piece of toast. For lunch? Oh, there's a big variance there. The question is, the question that comes up, should I have a full sandwich or a half sandwich of hummus? So there's a big choice there. And when it comes to dinner, I look forward to dinner. As I've already said, I like, really enjoy the soup and salad that we would have.
Dad, one thing we've never understood is that we would often give you a choice. Would you like A or would you like B?
Yeah.
Would you like a piece of cake or would you like the cookie?
Yeah.
Now, sometimes you understood the choice, which is you say, I'd have some of both. But many times you'd say, whatever you like.
Right, yeah.
Could you explain that?
No, it's not whatever you like. It's question really refers to my saying, whatever's open. It deals with wine. I can have white wine, I can have red wine. It really doesn't make that much difference to me. And I hate to be wasteful, whether it's for myself or anybody else. So if somebody has opened a bottle of wine and nobody else is going to be drinking, in other words, if they're going to open a bottle of wine for me, because I specifically say I want white wine, and I think nobody else is going to drink it, I'm not happy with that. I find it wasteful. So I say to them, whatever is open, whatever is anyone else is drinking, I'll have that. I know a lot of people don't like that. They say, make a choice. That is my choice, whatever is open.
What is your favorite late night snack, assuming you were able to snack on anything before you went to bed?
Whatever's available.
Whatever's open. Whatever's open.
Whatever I could find.
Right. Oh.
Now, since living with Ruth, do you feel you've gotten to eat as much bread as you would have made on your own?
I've always been a bread eater.
I know, but Ruth is also seems to be a very aggressive bread eater.
She is.
Does she leave enough for you?
I tell you this, if it weren't for the fact that we both like bread as much as we do, I don't know if we would be together.
Is there a particular type of bread that you like?
I like rye bread, I guess. I like a chunky bread, a heavy bread, yeah.
Now, Dad, in your leisure time, one thing that I've always thought about is that you always seem to have a passion to travel. And for going, you know, of course, the jobs that you and Mom had gave you time that not every working person had to travel, but you guys would always go on a trip every summer. Much to for Lori and I, it worked out great. We got the run of the house oftentimes. And we also got to hear about your travels. But where did that love of travel come from? Do you have any idea?
I don't even know if I had a love of travel as such. It was something I wanted to do. Maybe it's because it was available. You know, I had the time, it was available. But I enjoyed it because I was able to pick up a sense of the various cultures and the history of the places we visited. I did love looking at mountains. In fact, when we went cross country, you know, you and Lori and Mommy and I, of course, and we were out 10 weeks, 7 of those weeks we were traveling, so we hit a good part of the country. And I thought it was gorgeous. That was one of the best trips I've ever taken.
It was a great trip.
Yeah.
But you like the mountains more than the seaside, you said.
Yeah, I prefer the mountains to the seaside, right. Yeah.
that in all the places you've gone to, any of them you would, that you said, gee, I'd like to live there, or the way they live is makes sense to me, and I would like to take some of those aspects of the way they live and incorporate them in how I live?
Well, I have no regrets having been born and living in the United States. I don't think there's any other country I would have preferred being, you know, living at, or in, rather. But probably if I was born in England, I would have been happy in England, or Sweden, or Denmark, or any of those countries. But I did want to say something. Oh, in terms of where I would really have liked to have gone back at some time, would have been what's called the Lake Country, which is in England, and it was gorgeous. So I always said I'd like to get back there again and just walk through. It was mountainous, lakes.
So Wales, that is that?
Wales? Is that, it wasn't the, Wales, no.
It was England.
This was in England proper. Uh-huh. Wales, I loved Wales. Wales was, I thought it was beautiful. It was very mountainous. I preferred Wales to Scotland. Scotland was pretty, but I preferred.
What were your feelings,
because
I know you volunteered in Israel,
I didn't discuss volunteering in Israel, no?
No.
All right. After Mommy died, she died in February of 1978, Lori suggested, having been in Israel previously for a period of, what was it, about 6-8 months, something like that, yeah, on the kibbutz and traveling around. Lori said, Dad, why don't Michael and Lori, of course, and myself take a trip to Israel that summer. So that was the summer of 78, and which we did, and that was a very good trip. We had 1 week we rented a car on our own, and for 2 weeks we went as a tour, which was having to be an excellent tour. I think it was the American Zionist Organization. But in terms of my volunteering, okay. When I was with Anne, we decided we'd like to volunteer in Israel. So anyway, they had a 3 month volunteer program, a 2 month volunteer program. We took the 2 month program, and they headquartered us in a hotel in Netanya, which is on the Mediterranean, was right on the Mediterranean. And you had to do something, obviously, as a volunteer. So Anne and I went into an elementary school and tutored kids in English. We were ESL people. We weren't certified, and we didn't get paid, but we did as good a job as you guys. And in addition, what they did was they took us on trips, some of which lasted 3 days, some was just for 1 day, and so forth. So it was a very good experience.
Your connection with your having never studied Hebrew, but having been bar mitzvahed, having been asked to do the bracha over the challah for 60 years and still struggling with that prayer.
Bless you.
Always in my mind raised questions about sort of what your feelings were about religion and the rest. And obviously, to me, it was very important that our family be Jewish, and that Lori and I marry Jewish, have a Jewish life. What's your feeling now about how well your religion has served you?
Well, certainly I wanted my children to have a Jewish background, and I felt that was independent of whether they were religious or not. Because Judaism, as we all know, has so many aspects to it, not only the religion, but the culture. The Jews have this language that sort of binds them together, no matter where they're from. And of course, you're affected by what you, how you grow up. I grew up in a Jewish home, and I tend to be comfortable with Jews, although I've had friends who are not Jewish. And I went to a high school which was essentially not Jewish, so that was not a problem.
When you married Mom, and she came from a more religious home than you did, was and they celebrated the holidays to a greater extent. Grandpa Klein went to, was an avid synagogue goer. They kept kosher. Did that, was that a problem adjusting, or did you find that comfortable?
No. Hey, actually, when Mommy and I established our own home, we decided to be, she said she'd like to be kosher because her parents were kosher. And so that when they came to have a meal with us, they'd be comfortable. And I didn't have any problem with that, no. I thought this is something that had to be done, you know. The interesting thing is, though, that when we came up here, we were not kosher. And maybe because, of course, they weren't as involved coming up here as they obviously did when we were living in the city.
Do you feel that over time, you're never much of a temple goer, and later on in life you used to go occasionally on Friday night. Do you feel like you've become more connected, more desire for some spiritual things now than when you were younger, or that really hasn't changed much?
No, there's been a progression over the years. When I was bar mitzvah, I indicated I was bar mitzvah. I liked, is it called film? When you're, yeah. Mm-hmm. I did the film for a while, then stopped that. At some point, I felt I was an agnostic. There was I didn't know whether or not there was a God or there wasn't a God, so agnostic. And then eventually I progressed into a feeling of, I don't feel there's anybody up there pulling strings. You know, the question is, how was the universe established? I don't know. But it was. And so I'm comfortable feeling that I'm an atheist, but along with that, I feel I'm as strong a Jew as the religious Jew in terms of a sense of Judaism.
When you think back, you've had 93 years, is there something that makes you particularly proud that you, when you think of it, you yourself feel, I'm so pleased that this, I accomplished this, or I led my life in a certain way, that you think about?
No, I don't, but, you know, you raise the question, and paramount in my mind would be that both you and Lori have turned out, and your offspring, you know, have turned out to be very stable individuals. I have no concern about your making a living. My feeling always has been if someone is stable, I'm talking about mentally, of course, and they're reasonably intelligent, they're gonna do okay. They'll make a living. And the important thing is that your needs are satisfied, because I think the worst thing for someone is to have desires beyond which they can attain. So I think both you and Lori, and my sense is that the offspring are in pretty good shape along those lines.
And are you saying that you're taking, as I think you should, a sense of pride in being part of whatever it took to bring Lori and I to that point and teach us a certain way and to pass that on. Is that the pride you're feeling, or you're happy that when you look back and you say you feel you're happy, that's an outcome that you're that makes you at ease? But that's not the question I asked. I asked, when you look back and think about your role and your life, what it is that you can look back on with satisfaction and pride.
Michael, I don't look back and say, gee, because I did this or I did that, things turned out as I hoped they would be. Mm-hmm. I did at the time what I thought was it should be done. In some cases, I'm sure, you know, it may have been excessive one way or the other. But overall, I assume I did a reasonable job because, look, you two guys, and as I say, the offspring are in good shape.
And I guess
so I don't look at it as pride, you know, taking pride. It was something that existed, and I did what I thought should be done, and that's it.
And I guess I would go further, and when I think about the model that I had for my child and how I wanted her to turn out, and that my role, it was so easy as a parent to want to be friends with your kid, and you do want to be friends, but you need to teach them to be an adult. And I felt that you weren't always my friend. You often could be a disciplinarian, and you could be harsh, I could resent you. Of course, you also were a friend. But you turned me into an adult at a relatively young age, I felt, but in an appropriate age, and I felt that the same was true for Lori. And we've been successful with our kids, although they're not always acting like adults. But they are, relative to other kids, you know, they're independent. And I owe it to you, I think. And I think you should look back at that with a great deal of satisfaction. And it just wasn't happenstance.
Yeah. Well, there's satisfaction, obviously. As I say, I don't take pride. I don't say to myself, you know, I'm terrific because my kids had turned out to be terrific. No, it was, to repeat, it was something that I thought, I felt at the time should be done. I should act in a certain manner, whether you liked it or not. And that was it. Luckily, it turned out okay.
Mm-hmm. Dad, how about, there's a sort of the flip side of the coin, which is that, are there things that you wish had been worked a little differently? Obviously, we wish Mom hadn't gotten sick, although that brought other wonderful people into our lives, as it turned out. But are there things you can think about that you wish you had made a different decision?
Well, I can't wish back to those things that might have occurred over which we had no control.
Absolutely.
But the choices I made turned out to be okay for me, and I think for the family. Didn't make a tremendous amount of money, but I never had the feeling I needed it. I did whatever I had to do in order to make what's commonly called a living. I worked three jobs at one time. You know, I taught during the day, I taught at night, which is the second job, and I used to work for Uncle Sidney as a custom peddler. So whatever I had to do, and then I would work during the summer. So whatever I had to do, I did to satisfy our needs. But I did okay. We were able to travel. I was able to send the kids to college. Able to clothe ourselves in an adequate fashion. We're able to go to the theater frequently. So, you know, it was a good life.
Mm-hmm. Well, Dad, I don't know. I'll open it up to others to ask questions, but let me just say that the love of your grandchildren and your children for you just a real indication of the success and the sustenance you gave us, and we thank you for that.
Well, I thank you for that. You know, This has not come from one direction. Of course, mommy was involved as well, but it was something within the offspring that caused them to become what they are. I'm a firm believer that we're all born with certain characteristics, and that those characteristics are perhaps molded to some extent by the environment. You know, the environment being people out there and people close to us. And so, look, all I can say is that I've been fortunate that things have turned out as they have. You know, I've been fortunate also, not that mommy died, obviously, but as you already said, when Anne came on board, she worked out very well with the kids, my kids, and the grandchildren. And I worked out with Matthew, her son. And when Ruth came aboard, exactly the same sort of thing. My sense is that I know that she gets along beautifully, and my kids love her. And hopefully there's a similar relationship with her children.
Thank you, Doug.
So we've been talking about purchasing another summer house. So if you could talk a little bit about what was your thinking. This was your idea.
Okay, yeah. I don't know if we've discussed this with this interview or not, but at some point, I guess it was about a year and a half ago, the thought came to me that it would be nice if we had another house close by where we are now. And the reason was that I knew, I expected, obviously, that with time, the grandchildren would hopefully get married and have children of their own. That was always a strong possibility. And the house that we're in now, we can accommodate everybody. It would be an impossible situation years down the road. So I threw out a thought, and it came about possibly because also next door, Blanche, Sam had died, and we thought that Blanche would be interested in selling the place, and if we were able to buy that house, that would be an ideal situation because we'd have to sort of have a little compound here. I told everybody, we had a meeting last summer, and I indicated what I was willing to do financially in terms of purchasing a house and providing some additional money to run that household for a period of 10 years. And it came about that everybody was in agreement. Oh, and the other thing, obviously, the only reason I would have thought about having another place up here is because all of the three grandchildren loved coming up here. So, I thought it was the way to go.
Okay. Thank you, Dad. Yeah.
You're welcome.
Beautiful.
Thank you.
Thank you, Grandpa.
In other words, baby, kiss me. Fill my heart with song and let me sing forevermore. You are all I long for, all I worship and adore. In other words, please be true. In other words,